Okay. Flocculant elements. Elements that migrate even through other solid areas. As I wrote in a poem once, in silence grow the elements that wrestle thus with time, the eventful and the eloquence of velvet and sublime. Where grows the lily of the field in metamorphic speech, to tell the kings that will not yield, where value thus doth meet? No robes of opulence are like the blossom which all see, while in this world they trek a pike that wends eternally. We're so used to containers. I tell you, we are so used to containers, containers, containers. I even recycle them, you know. This used to be flan, queso, en pedazo. You know, and I wondered where this went. The screwdriver. This is two little ceramic statues, an eagle and a tortoise, from a tea packet. Oh, look! A hot wire cable. I've been wondering where you went all this time. Here's my old address book. See, I put it place where I wouldn't forget it. Hey, it worked, didn't it? You saw it. The only problem is now I can't get it to fit back there. Should have taken anatomy photographs first. I hope I remember where that little clue-drival went. So I'll have to get another flan queso, because this one's wearing out. Yeah. It isn't whatever, it's wherever. So packets. There's packets everywhere. Yabba dabba doo. That's Yogi Bear. This made up a little poem there. So, okay. We're so used to containers. You know, I even wrote an article about that. The little town that invented the container made more of a dent in history than the Roman Empire. You know, that's Shkokwe. Very bad accent. It's Tlinkit, little Tlinkit place. Tlinkits would never go there. It was too windy. They thought only crazy people would go there. But it ended up being a great gold rush town, and the subsequent intelligentsia of the United States migrated all over there to get the gold. And then their children invented the container. Yes, it is not just a little hidden town up there in the panhandle of Alaska. No. These were the children of the intelligentsia of not only perhaps the United States, but the planet. Then after that, they all went to Australia, mate. Yeah, they went out to Campbell, I think, to get the gold out there. See, in Australia, different part of the star system. So the microgravity of the universe dictates Australia does not press its tongue against the molars, mate. Like to make a You curve and press against the molars, and you get your which is commonplace in the United States. It's a kind of a violent language, actually. So, containers. There. Instead of saying there, they say they. Secret is not to press your tongue against your molars. And you'd be I have to say, fading come one of these days. I still can't do it. I mean, if any Australian heard me say that, they would be laughing right now, or chuckling anyway. So, okay. So the containers range from... Now, the reason for these containers, the reason why it's more significant than the Roman Emperor, or Empire, was, okay, what happened is these guys trying to adapt to a cold climate by establishing what they called unitized freight, ran into accidentally what the human brain is incapable of comprehending, and that is ratios. It's impossible for them to understand ratios. So they stumbled upon it with the container, and they found out by sacrificing some space, the use of multiple containers, or as they call it, not containers, they called it unitized freight. By unitizing the freight, they were able to increase the incidence of concourse. That gave them a ratio of concourse. Now, the Romans could have done that a long time ago, but instead of building containers, they just put the continents to cargo, which were continents in things like clay jugs and other things, into the hold as geometrically well as they could possibly conceive, you see. So it took that long, a couple of thousand years, before they began to learn how to unitize the freight. It's a combination. It's North Americans, United States Americans, and Canadian Americans working in a consort. What was it called? The White Pass and Yukon Railroad. WPYR. I call it Whopper for short. Anyway, so we're so used to things being contained that we fail to realize that we are in a very fluid and dynamic world, in fact, universe. The very solids themselves can also in some way be subject to displacement, replacement, and other forms of movement or transportation within, among, around, and even through the lattices of other solids. Did you copy on that one, good buddy? It would be very interesting to set up experiments like this in which something contained in a glass beaker could be made to move through the glass to the outside of said beaker by the placing of some substance in the location of its destination. The rudimentary experiments would establish perhaps the physics of the properties of the connectivity between the substance to flocculate and its attractor. All right, now you have caldera up in around Dawson in Alaska, and the gold that has been brought up somehow, probably by the subduction over there of the Pacific Ring of Fire, quote-unquote, causes a permineralization, not permineralization, that's wrong, that's fossilization of things, causes a colloidal suspension of the gold atoms in hydrogen hydroxide water, and this colloidal suspension causes the gold to be transported from the caldera to the quartz. If found in conjunction with iron, will create the right electrolysis to plate the gold upon the quartz. Now here you see, because of my perspiration in my pocket, working with the quartz, The copper from the pennies in my pocket have plated over a series of 2 or 3 years onto this white quartz. Flocculates, buddy. I mean, how else could we put it? Flocculate is a good word. It probably is used in the industry for something entirely different, like the flocculation of, what was that stuff called? Getting old. It's going to take me 20 seconds to remember. I wonder if I can stall you guys for 20 seconds. Alum. They put alum on top of water. The alum flocculates together and settles to the bottom, pulling the contaminants of the water along with it. This is one way of city systems, what would we call them? Not urban. Anyway, I used to be able to belt this stuff out. Anyway, you know the drill on that. It's part of water, just like that. This one word for flocculating, that's how they taught it to us in high school. But the very solids themselves, you see, can also, in some way, be subject to displacement. So it'd be interesting to set up an experiment, you know, get something to go through the glass beaker, you know. It may be surmised that even that every situation between the flocculant and its attractor is a form of conductivity, even if it portends resistance or continence. Now, I don't know if continence is the right word. I mean, containance. Maybe I invented a new word, but I'm a poet. I mean, look, I made a living as a poet for like 12 years. I wrote the poetry, put it to music, sang it on the streets, you know, and took a collection, buddy. It qualifies on a technicality, so I have poetic license. I can say containance, okay? Resistance or containance. Arguably, in an instance of containance, transpirency comes from the word transpire. It's a conjugation of the verb transpire, putting it into, an adjective, I suppose. Yeah, it ends in a Y or something like that. I don't know. I used to teach English, but, you know, that was only just to make a living in developing nations so I could do my investigations there. Okay. Let's see. Where am I? You know, so it pretends resistance or containance. Arguably, an instance of containance, transpirency. For the time, the flocculant is transpiring through the substance of the container or barrier. In such an instance, it becomes a part of the substance of the barrier, or an aspect of the consistency of its aggregate. It probably becomes a molecule thereof, you know? Okay? Now look, guys, this is probably going on in geology all along. It may be common knowledge, but hey, just because I thought of it, there are applications of this, you know? Here, Rover, here, okay, open the ducts, here comes the iron. Okay, how much we got? 5 tons, that's it. That's all we can hold. Okay, rest you go home. Aw, shucks. Sorry, Charlie. Better luck next time. Can you use some for magnetite? Yeah, pretty good. We could put it on Broadway. Magnets and tights. Oh, man. Okay, so it may be surmised the situation between the flocculant and its attractor is a form of conductivity, you know. The instance of containance transpirency. I mean, I couldn't say continence transpirency because that's probably a different word. So, okay, it becomes a part of the substance of the barrier, consistency of the aggregate, even though it is in a state of motion. Now, how would we describe that state of motion? In normal terms, you wouldn't get your iron to gallop to like the 2-ton container, you know, the 5-ton container over there, for the, you know, like designer steel industry somewhere. You know, forget the truck, it just comes in from the basement, we'll get in, comes in through the basement. No, what we're talking about here is the transpirance of geologic time here. But now we're going to come up with the argument, can this be accelerated for industrial purposes without causing isostatic compensation? You know. What was that, a 0.5? No, it's only the designer steel next door. We must steel ourselves against that distraction. Yeah, we already had 5 buildings collapse, but, you know, they weren't made for, like, you know, flocculant migration on accelerated level. What? I don't get it. <You know? laughs> This is funny. I'm having a good time here for a change, man. I don't know. Maybe only one or two people are watching this, but I'm having fun doing this. Okay. This has a myriad of applications and uses that can tend to eliminate the encumbrance of mechanization. how come, you know, Saudi Arabia has all the oil? Well, maybe they did something right and it caused it to flocculate over there. We want to go where they like us, you know. Yeah, we don't want to go to Texas. The heck with that. Let's go where they like us out in Arabia. You know, okay, we're out of here, man. Okay, this was a concept, you know, I had even as a boy, you know, or at least one aspect of it, the use of crystallysis in architecture. Now, you got sci-fi about that. I just saw something from, watching Netflix, Stargate, you know, and I forgot who they are. The form of the Gould who decided the Gould became altruistic. I can remember, but I just can't do that right now. I can't stall for 20 seconds here. Hey, maybe it's 25. You know, you never know what happens when you get a few years older. But the Tok'ra. I got my 20 seconds. Let me have a toke off of that reefer, huh? <You know? laughs> To what do you refer? Okay, so, the Tok'ra came up with an ability to cause crystallysis to create caverns for their operation centers. It's like, okay, switching on. There we go. I got our housing, man. It's underground. Why not? Well, why? You know, it's like, hey, first of all, it's not a target except for penetrating bombs. And the other thing is, it's always cool in here. You don't have to spend a lot of money for the air conditioning. Yeah, okay. Oh, cool. How about heat? Well, man, you just keep your sweater on. It's heated, too, by the planet. It's even 55 degrees year-round. Hey, that's 55. Don't complain. One of those degrees has got to be a PhD. Oh, well, that's okay then, you see. So I had a concept of using crystallysis in architecture. Who hasn't as a kid? Imagine that. You plant the crystal. I guess maybe I don't think I got it from Superman's, Fortress of Solitude, you know. Because it wasn't that way before the movie. It was like a big cave, you know, or something like that. Anyway, So the nature of chemistry and what we have recorded as our cute, you know, I mean, I used to use this thing called cute FTP, you know. It was better than trying to use the FTP in Microsoft's front page. QTP was ironclad, especially, you know, the third upgrade. But anyway, this is what we call the cute periodic table of the elements. You know. No, that's the periodic table of the elephants. You know. Okay. I got 10 puns lining up. I just sort of put a block on that one here. Okay, so the nature of the chemistry that we have recorded in our cute little periodic table of the elements, you know, goes far beyond anything we can even understand or construe. Our role as intelligent beings with the gift of motility is that we can actually bring certain elements into play using our memory, our studies, and our data from our research, and quite often many other qualities such as intuition. This is a vital quality of the good scientist. Intuition, baby. I'm not kidding, man. You know, I mean, you got a big education. I've had people say that to me. Imagine they're saying it to everybody else. They can't say anything because they don't have the degree. They don't have the education. They don't have the pedigree. Buddy, you have to have a lot more than education to be a scientist. In the first place, a decent IQ would help. But more than that, you have to have intuition, just like other things. I mean, one guy discovered organic chemistry in a dream, for crying out loud. Get real. I mean, real is different than you think real to be. I mean, real to real. Here we go. So, but you cut and slash boys in your back rooms messing around with your toxicity, you know, you've got the wrong concept there with your chemistry, man. You haven't even touched on the possibility of the nature of the actual total concept of true chemistry or advanced human science. I mean, all this time you've been messing around with complex chain molecules and your infatuation with the halogens, phenols, formaldehydes, and so on and so forth, and on they go. You've had right before you, all around your environment, weeds growing right out of concrete cracks, trees growing out of the soil, and even in your basic studies, a primitive knowledge of crystallysis itself, and also the reaction of elements and molecules with each other, which really is the basis of chemistry, not the plunking of tricky little elementary school days chemistry set chemicals into caustic solutions. You thought organic chemistry was for the other guys, a completely different branch of chemistry for the greenies with their heads in the clouds. But in one sense, it actually is a reliable example of the migration of elements. So you say, all right, it's organic. I don't want to talk about it then. Hey, man, I said, it's just one example. Okay, here's a hypothetical principle of flocculant attractions. I said hypothetical. An element or molecule can, under certain circumstances, exhibit or undertake the tendency to migrate through a solid, a mixture, a colloid, a solution, any range of barriers, including those of liquid, gas, and even through the void of outer space and over appreciable distance, when attracted by the right combination of chemicals or molecules situated in the location of its attraction. This is the principle of organic molecules performing a function within a cell or migrations of elements at a given distance from a follicle, such as root hair, or monocellular fibers extending from a micro root hair. Now, back to the drawing board, kids. Back to the drawing board. And let's come up with something interesting this time. I mean, you may find out that all of these flocculant migrants and their attractors are totally non-toxic. Unless, of course, the organic molecule is something indigenous to Titan.